Hello and welcome, I'm Kiz Scribner, and today I'm going to be doing middle grade magic recommendations, but these recommendations are gold all of the time. But the readathon that I'm hosting is going to be going from July 10th to the 18th, and the co-hosts and the prompts will be listed below. And I'm going to be talking about them randomly and just putting the authors' names, which they go together, all on the bottom somewhere. So the first one is Pet by Amezi, and this is such an extraordinary novel. I adore it so much. It has the representation of a trans black lead who is selectively mute, and yet it's not focused on that. It's focused on her story and the story of her best friend and them dealing with monsters, and monsters that people don't believe that there's monsters, and how do you fight the monsters when there isn't this? And it's a very well done middle grade novel that talks about very serious subjects of sexual abuse, but in a way that I think that it's very evident what's going on if you are familiar with that, but I think that it's also something that's very digestible for younger kids. The next book that I have is Alana the First Adventure, and I'm going to put this a little bit with the first test. These are two books that are by Tamora Pierce, and they are first in a series, and they're series that go from like middle grade into adult. Alana's story takes place where she twists with her brother, who is named Tom, and she pretends like her name is Alan, and she wants to become a knight and he wants to become a sorcerer. So it's her story going up, and this one is really cool, and she's masquerading. And then we have Kel's story, which is the next one, and she is the first female knight to be admitted on her own grounds. Like, they know that she's a girl. And both of them are so wonderful. I definitely like Kel's story definitely better, but it's still just a great story. The Girl Who Drank the Moon by Kelly Barnhill. This is a delightful story. We have the story where we have the witch who goes and steals babies, except for what they don't know is that they keep on sacrificing babies, and the witch is like, okay, I will take these children. And she like gives them a little bit of moonlight to like, and takes them across the forest and lets them be adopted by people, and then they've kind of become the chosen ones because they have a little bit of her magic. And then there's this one baby that she gives like tons of magic to, and we follow that girl, and it's like a sweet story, and it's a twist on mythology and all of that, and it's absolutely lovely. Then we have The Giver by Lois Lowry. This is a favorite of mine. It is so well done. It is a dystopian novel about this world in which there is no colors, and our protagonist is given the job of the receiver to become the giver. There is one person, the giver, who has knowledge of the past world, and like the world that they're living in like does not have color, like love does not exist. Like, you know, he asks at one point because he's becoming more knowledgeable about it because the giver is growing older and he has to receive the knowledge, and he figures out what like love is and what like snow is and what all of these things, and he like goes to his parent because they're like parent operation or something like that, like they're assigned and like all of these things, like it's very like mechanical, and he's like, do you love me? And he's like, that's not the correct language you can use, and it's like the exactness of language. And like, I don't know, I could go on about this book forever because it's just such a well done story, and it also deals with really heavy subjects as well. Other Words for Home, and this is another favorite novel. It is a novel in verse by Jasmine Warga, and it deals with a Syrian refugee who comes with her mother, and I really love Jude. She is such a great protagonist, and it has so much joy as well as the suffering, and her wanting to be an actor, and her, you know, having her first period and putting her hijab on and what that means for her and how that changes, and just so many reflections on herself and like living with her uncle who married a white woman, so her like, and the disconnection there, and like, it's just such a lovely story. And then we have Crystal Ribbon by Celeste Ling, and she wrote this as her MFA project, which was super cool. And this is a book that is about a 12-year-old girl who is of Chinese heritage. She lives in China in like the 12th century, and she's very poor, and she is married to a 12-year-old boy. Or sorry, she's married to a 2-year-old boy and she's 12. So she has to like nurse him and raise him, which is just super creepy. And she's just like pretty much his nanny, and she's gonna be like his wife of like lower descent and stuff like that. And it's her story. I can also put Grace Lynn in this. It's one of the prompts, so she's kind of an automatic recommendation here, but she also writes mid-century medieval Chinese stories with mythology and stuff like that, and they're really good. Before the Ever After by Jacqueline Woodson, and it is, the protagonist is ZJ, and his father is a very famous football player, and he's in middle school, and his father is playing less games, and he's having headaches, and he's becoming angry, and it's dealing with CTE, which is the disease in the mind that affects after many, many concussions, and I sobbed so much. Having invisible disability and illness represented on page was so emotional for me, And it's something that I went through my same, trying to figure out what happened. And CTE is something that like we thought of and all of these things. And it is such a poignant story about illness and how illness affects families. And I just think that everyone should read this book. Also, Brown Girl Dreaming by Jacqueline Woodson is also extraordinary. It's a memoir, but it's written in this very, like, it's written in verse and it's so poignant and emotional. And we get to see really cool moments, like right when she's born, I believe in 1964, if I'm correct, we get to see, like, you know, Martin Luther King and Malcolm X, and we get to see all of these different characters, and she references to history, and then we also see her, where she grows up, her difference between living in Ohio and then the South somewhere, and then New York, and it's just such a poignant novel, and it reads like a novel, even though it's a memoir, and yeah, it's just such a great book. Then we have a classic, and this is Tuck Everlasting. I was surprised by how much I liked it. It is such a cute story about this girl who really just wants to, like, go out and live the world. She's very much like shut in by Victorian like culture and setting and stuff like that. And she meets this boy and she meets this family that are living forever. And it's about like eternity, but also just like choosing what your fate is. And it's also just a really sweet story. We also have Ella Enchanted, which is a great story. I read them together and that was super great. And this, I grew up with the movie, so I was surprised how different it was, but they are both great. This one is just a story about a girl finding her voice. I really enjoy it as a Cinderella retelling because not everything is set up in the beginning. Like, we watch her stepmother come in, we watch these different things happen, and I think that it's so well done. For the classic prompt, we definitely have a lot of whitewashed things because there isn't a lot of classics because of, you know, racism. But Roll of Thunder, Hear My Cry is an extraordinary novel. It's by Mildred D. Taylor, and she wrote this in 1963, and it's set in the 1930s, and it's about land, and it's about this family who came up from slavery and, you know, built their own foundation. Now they're in the Great Depression and they're dealing with the racism and the lynching and all of the things that are happening that are trying to stop. And it's a story about them wanting to boycott the white people that are being racist, but they're also worried that if they fail, and especially because they can afford it more because they have their own land, but a lot of other people can't. And it's like, how do you actually react to injustice, or do you allow injustice? Because injustice is the only way you might be able to survive. And it's a family saga, and I think she just released like the final book this year. Like, this woman has been writing the book for like 60 years off and on. And I think she started when she was quite like young, and now she's like in her 80s or something. So I'm very excited to read this and like get the saga of their family. Ghost Boys by Jewel Parker Rhodes is such an extraordinary novel. It takes a place with Jerome, who is a 12-year-old black boy living in New York City, who is shot in the back by a police officer when he is holding a toy gun. And he dies, and we see his ghost interacting with the ghost of Emmett Till, who is a boy who was killed in the 1950s. At 14 years old for winking at a white woman who, you know, later came out and said, yeah, I made it up. And his lynched body, that was heroic. His mother made him be shown as a testament to the fact that she would not stand by and quietly dispose of her son. His tragedy was part of the beginning of the civil rights movement, and it's horrific, but it matches the story of his story to Jerome and what is currently happening with police brutality. We also have him interacting with a girl, Sarah, who unknowingly is connected to the police officer who shot him. And what does it mean to be an ally? What does it mean to all of these things? And conversation of history and allyship and police brutality, and especially around children's and stuff like that. It's a really poignant and really hard novel, but I think that it's such an important book. For Black Girls Like Me by Mariama J. Lockingston is such an extraordinary novel. It is about this girl who is a transracial adoption. She is black, her older sister and parents are white, and they definitely, like, eroticize is the wrong word, but like, you know, fantasticize her and all of these things, but not actually giving her, you know, she feels so lonely even though she's surrounded by all of these people who do love her but don't understand her. And she has now moved across the country. We have her mother who's experiencing bipolar, but it's currently undiagnosed. And there's a lot going on in this novel, but I really, really loved it. Some people said it's overcrowded, but for me, I really love novels that are very intersectional and very much affect many different things. We have her being homeschooled. We have the family dynamics. We have her sisters and the story of like her fear of turning out like their mother and the fear that mental health is inevitable, and like the disconnections and the way that people disconnect on a family level is so nuanced and so good. Then we have Nevermore by Jessica Townsend. This is a book that got me back into middle grade, and I'm so thankful for it. It is this whimsical story where this 12-year-old girl who is cursed and like supposed to die on her 12th birthday actually gets taken to this magical world to compete in a games to enter the Wonder Society, and she doesn't even know what her knack is, which is her power. And it's just like these cool things where, like, you know, you use umbrellas to like get around on, like, you know, hooking them onto like trains and stuff like that. And I don't know, I just really enjoy the friendship and the world, especially the world building and the whimsy of it. It is such a great story, and I love the found family, and the humor is on point. The False Prince is a story about a boy who is very poor, who is enlisted by an elderly gentleman who is rich and a duke, I think, to try to pretend to be the prince of this nation, because the prince disappeared many, many years ago, and now the rest of the family is being killed. And he takes about like 3 or 4 guys, and he's like, I'm gonna train you to be a prince. And it's his story, and it's super great. I don't like the sequels very much, but the first one is just gold. We have Witchwood by Tahira Mafi, and this is a story that is very centered around grief. And we have this girl who has lost her mother, and yet she also has to bury the people in the village. Her mother was the person who washed the bodies of the deceased, and now that's on her. And it's really about a story about finding home in one another. And, you know, we have the author writing to the actual reader and addressing and breaking the fourth wall, which is such a favorite trope of mine, and it's just such a lovely, beautifully written and delivered story. Then we have Aryusha and the End of Time, and I love this series as well. And it is about this girl who is living in a museum, and her mother is a curator, and then she discovers that she's a Hindu reincarnation of a Hindu god. And she meets her sister, and they go on adventures. And the first one is really fun. The second one, I really connected with the story, and I connected with the new character that was introduced and the things around abandonment and found family. Then we have Coraline by Neil Gaiman. If you're anything like my childhood, you were terrified by like trailers of Coraline and never watched it. And then as an adult, you read it. And it's a story about like abuse and loneliness and all of these things, and her being disconnected and going into this place with an alternate mother. I literally have goosebumps on the back of my neck when talking about this. Like, I think this might just be like the childhood fear. It's a really cool, well-written, it's Neil Gaiman, it's awesome. And then we have some classics. We have Narnia and The Hobbit are both middle grade books that are wonderful and don't always age in some aspects, but are definitely full of magic and wonder and whimsy and great characters that I love and adventures. Then we also have Percy Jackson, and, you know, Rick Riordan is the king of middle grade, so I didn't bring him up until the end, but it is the story that, you know, got me into reading so much. I really love Magnus Chase series. It is a favorite of mine as well. I thought that the mythology of Norse and the characters there, Alex owns my heart, so does Magnus, and, you know, so does Percy and Nico. Nico is still my crush. I went through the whole journey with him, and I was there every day the first day that the Heroes of Olympus came out, even though they're not as much my favorite. And yeah, I just really, really love Rick Riordan's world, and I think that's a great way to end it. And yeah, this is my very informal reading of recommendations that I think that are great and that you should totally check out. And there's many more. So I hope that you join us on our readathon. If you want to enter a giveaway for Orphe's Ghost, which is a story about a black girl growing in the 1920s, after her father dies, she begins to see ghosts, and Kara's holding a giveaway for it. And all you have to do is enter your favorite middle grade author, or if you're getting into middle grade, an author that you're really excited to read. And have a great day, and happy reading and writing.